Hi, I'm Matthias and this is Hedy, and welcome to Study Time's Level 2 Mechanics exam strategy video.
Mechanics is mostly the study of motion. At NCA, the branch of mechanics you'll be mostly focusing on is classical mechanics, which is concerned with the movement of large objects. At level 2, this paper is broken down into a few key concepts: linear motion, circular motion, projectile motion, forces and torques, and momentum and energy. But it's unlikely that a question will just focus on one of these things. More likely that the examiners will try and mix things up, so you need to make sure you know how to recognise what you're being asked for.
The questions will mainly involve calculations and explanations. Get very comfortable with physical principles like conservation of energy and conservation of momentum. Another big part of this topic is getting you to explain what happens when something in the system changes. To explain this, you'll need to back up your answer using equations, so make sure you practice this. If you listen to the tips and strategies that we outline in this video, you're on your way to success. This standard requires really confident use of mathematics, particularly trigonometry, for things like resolving vectors into their horizontal and vertical components. You'll also have to use scientific notation to convert non-SI units like millimeters into the SI unit meters. You'll also have to round your answer to the correct number of significant figures. A general rule of thumb is that you round to the least number of significant figures given in the question.
This year they also start to introduce the ideas of scalar and vector quantities. A scalar quantity is something like time. It has a size but it doesn't have a direction, so for example, 10 seconds. Whereas a vector quantity is one that has a size and a direction, something like velocity, 45 meters per second to the north. As well as just scalar and vector quantities, you're going to want to be familiar with all the terminology in this exam, because you can be thrown some really tricky explanation questions, and those marks come from using the right vocabulary. So, for example, you might want to use things like conservation of momentum, conservation of energy. Now, some of this terminology is really similar, so an elastic collision is when kinetic energy is conserved, and an inelastic collision is where it's not. But in both these cases, momentum is conserved. So you're going to want to make sure that you're really familiar with the actual concepts behind what's happening. Make sure you don't get muddled up by all these terms.
Mechanics involves a lot of equations. A lot of students simply rely on the fact that they have a formula sheet, but this isn't really enough. You need to understand what the equations mean and what their units are. A really good way of doing this is to make a big mind map with all of the equations and the symbol and what the symbols mean and what the units are. You'll also have to understand the relationship between one variable and another. To use the example of torque, what would happen to the torque if the force increased and the distance stayed the same? Well, because torque is directly proportional to the force, i.e. if everything else stays the same, it increases by the same amount that the force increases. So, the torque also increases.
Make sure you use the proper units all the way through your calculations. And most importantly, make sure that you've converted all your units into SI units before even starting to do any calculations. So for example, if you were given a distance in centimetres, before you did absolutely anything else, you should turn that into a metres distance. Finally, if you're not sure how to remember the units for a particular quantity, you can always sort of have a guess from the formula. So let's say I'd forgotten the unit newtons, but I'd calculated a force. And I might have the equation F equals ma in front of me. I know mass is measured in kgs. I know that acceleration is measured in meters per second squared. So when I multiply those together, I get kilograms meters per second squared. Now that's not the unit you're used to seeing for force, but both would be accepted by the markers. So you can always try this trick if you do forget a unit.
Calculations at the excellence level often require multiple steps and the use of physical principles to figure something out. A really good first step when solving these problems is just to write down everything you're given. Write the variable, its value, and of course its unit. The next step is to write down what you don't know. Then you can use your formula sheet and your understanding of physical principles to figure out what next steps to take. Let's take a look at an example like someone bouncing on a springboard, where the spring constant of the board is known, the mass of the person is known, and also the vertical displacement of them bouncing on the board. Well, we know that due to conservation of energy, all of this elastic potential energy will be converted to kinetic energy the moment they leave the board. So we can calculate the elastic potential using what is known, and we want to know the velocity, which requires setting EP equal to EK. Then we solve for EP, rearrange the whole equation for the velocity, and solve for that. There's a few steps involved, but if you practice it a lot, it should be relatively easy.
You'll also want to practice writing clear and concise answers. A lot of questions will ask you to link multiple concepts together, and if you're not fully confident in your understanding of them, this might take you quite a long time in the exam. You just won't get the sort of answers that markers are looking for. A good way to practice this is to do some timed questions in your own time, then mark them at the end to make sure that you can do a whole question in the 20 minutes. A good way to boost explanation questions is also to include a diagram. So, for example, a vector diagram. You'll also find that these are completely necessary in some calculation questions, such as projectile motion, where you need to resolve the one velocity into the horizontal and vertical components.
Descriptions and explanations at an excellence level require a little bit more in-depth justification and explanation. For example, in circular motion, you will have to explain why exactly there is an acceleration, even though the velocity of the object traveling in a circular motion doesn't change. For projectile motion, you'll have to explain how the vertical velocity changes as the object goes through its parabolic path. For energy and momentum conservation problems, you will have to justify your answers using the assumptions that you make. For example, all of the energy is converted into another form because none is lost due to friction, and that no external forces act, therefore momentum is conserved. We've covered some really important points. Make sure you go through the past 3 or 4 exam papers and make sure that you know what questions they may ask you.
But we'd also recommend checking out the study time guides. They're available for free online or to buy in print, and they're designed to help walk you through the entire content for the exam. So, good luck.
You're on your way to success. Why do you always do that?
It's my signature move.
Okay.
Do you have a better signature move for me to adopt?
Yeah, nothing.
I'm not going to do that.
Okay.